Hello and a warm welcome to our election trail interviews, and let's now get into the battleground Delhi, where polls are slated to be on 12th May. It's a triangular contest between BJP, Congress and the Aam Aadmi Party. What are the issues on the ground and how are the political odds stacked up? Joining me now is Union Minister Dr. Harsh Vardhan, who is also contesting from the Chandni Chowk constituency. I welcome you on the program.
Thank you.
My first question to you is related to your constituency. There is a feeling that whoever wins Chandni Chowk forms the government at the center. I just want to know, and maybe you can correct if I'm wrong, is that maxim right?
Honestly, I haven't heard about it, or at least I didn't know about that. But in the present circumstances, I'm sure that I'm going to win, and I'm also sure that Narendra Modi ji is going to form the government. So you can collate it with whatever your maxim is.
Okay. Dr. Harsh Vardhan, you've also been a four-time MLA from the Krishnanagar constituency of
five
East.
Times.
Five times MLA from the Krishnanagar constituency of East Delhi. There is a feeling that probably you could have contested from there as well. So what's your feeling?
You see, there was definitely an overwhelming majority of people in East Delhi, and my own workers, they were very keen and desperate that I should contest from East Delhi. Since all my life, 50 years I had spent there, 35 years of my practice, 20 years as an MLA. But here also, when I was asked to contest in 2014, I got a very rousing welcome. I got everybody's support, blessing, love, affection. And in the 5 years that I spent with my constituents here, people gave me a lot of respect and affection and blessings and everything. And there was an equal amount of desperation amongst the workers here in Chandni Chowk. Because wherever I used to go, they used to ask me, are you going to, because the media started all this, that I'll probably go to East Delhi. And because of that, there was so much of confusion in the minds of the workers in Chandni Chowk. They were facing a dilemma, and that means it's not exactly they, but I was facing this very particular dilemma, what should be done. But I was pretty clear from the day one that I'm not going to leave my constituency, because I've worked for them for 5 years. And on top of it, they have given me so much of affection, so much of respect. And now they are so eager that I should remain here. So I didn't want to betray them at all.
If I were to ask you to do a self-appraisal of yourself, what is that one quality which makes Dr. Harsh Vardhan the most universally accepted face in Delhi BJP?
It may not be fair for me to, number one, accept what you are saying. It may not be fair for me to sort of find out those qualities. It is for you to judge. It is for the people to judge. But I can only say that my public life started 25 years back. I have been a member of the RSS for 50 years now. On 1st of May, that is just about 5 days back, I completed 50 years of my RSS life. I joined RSS on 1st May 1969. So all these 50 years, I have been taught many great things, good things, best things by RSS in terms of values and how you sort of live for others, how you live for your country, how you live for your society. And I have tried to follow whatever has been taught to me by RSS. Even while I have been in this public life for 25 years, which I also I completed last year in October, October 2018. So while being in public life also, I have tried to maintain, you see, commitment for values, sincerity, dedication, honesty. I have always believed that the powers of honesty, truth, karma and love, compassion and the power of God, they are unbeatable. And I think I keep them close to my heart, and I try to sort of preserve them.
So those value systems keep you going. But let me now come to the issues which are resonating on the ground. The constituency of Chandni Chowk comprises a large chunk of the trader community. Now, when you talk about issues in your constituencies, what are the bread and butter issues which are resonating this election in your constituency?
You see, most of the issues that in fact were there in the constituency, I have taken care of most of them in the last 5 years. Say for traders, one of the major issues for people in Chandni Chowk used to be this chronic problem about parking, because there was no parking, so there was so much of congestion, so much of traffic issues and all. Now I have ensured that there is going to be a very modern 2400 capacity parking there, the work for which has already started. And similarly, I have already started work on almost a dozen parkings in the whole of Chandni Chowk parliamentary seat. I have got the Rani Jhansi flyover, which was, I think, one of the very important contentious issues which was troubling people for years, almost a decade. And to cross that small stretch, people used to be on the road for 1-2 hours, and now it's just about 5 minutes from one side going to the other side. I took it up as a passion, got all the hurdles removed, got some 85-90 crores from the central government, Mr. Venkaiah Naidu, and made sure that my dream of delivering it to the people of the constituency is realized within these 4-5 years. So I got it done. Similarly, so many other things.
Another instance for which Chandni Chowk really became notorious was the web of cables, which you cross the lanes and you find a web of cables. So have you been successful really in tackling that issue?
To be very honest with you, you see, this was one issue which I started working on. And I had a lot of meetings with Piyush Goyal, Mr. Piyush Goyal, my colleague, because he used to be the power minister. And we had in fact got the support system promised from the central government also for doing all this in Chandni Chowk. And I think it went on for almost 7-8 months. That was during the first year itself, 2014-2015.
Okay.
But unfortunately, after some time, we realized that the Delhi government stopped cooperating. Their officers stopped coming to these meetings. I don't know what was in their mind, why they... And then I tried to prevail upon the central government that they should give some money to the corporation or somewhere where we can somehow do it. But the system is such that you have to, for many things, you have to operate through the local government. And that's why I honestly couldn't do it. But suddenly it's my dream project. And 6 months from now, we'll have our own government in Delhi. I'm pretty confident that we'll eradicate Mr. Kejriwal and company from Delhi in the next 1 year or so. And then I think when we have our government at the center and in Delhi, we'll finish all these unfinished tasks, especially the Shahjahanabad developmental project also. I started with a lot of bank, and I wanted that tram also, but I spoke to Arvind Kejriwal personally also. But he didn't sort of cooperate, didn't agree. So that project also is still waiting.
According to the larger perception which the opposition parties are talking about, and of course everybody knows the demography of Chandni Chowk, a large trader community, and you know the way the opposition is whipping up the issue that, you know, there has been an impact of demonetization, there has been a certain impact of GST, and the traders have suffered losses. What is the actuality on the ground?
Opposition, because they don't have any agenda, they don't have any issues. Right now, the Congress party doesn't have any significant ground also in Delhi. So they have to raise such issues. But personally, I feel that the traders may have had some small resentment in the initial stages. But ultimately, when there were a huge number of amendments in GST also, like I discussed with the traders at different levels and with my own chartered accountants, and then I gave a huge list of suggestions to the Prime Minister himself on two occasions, and I found that 90% of the suggestions were implemented. When I asked my chartered accountant What do you feel about it? Have these concerns been addressed? He said, yes, sir, 90%. So, all these amendments that have been brought about in GST, they have been to address the issues which the people were suffering or which the people were resenting. So I don't see right now, generally people, they express their...
People have got used to the new system of GST.
Obviously, when you see the system changes, there is some disturbance. Like say you spoke about demonetization. Everyone in this country was standing in the queue. But I don't think anybody in this country ever doubted the intention of the Prime Minister.
Another issue which the opposition has really been whipping up is the issue of ceiling. How are you really going to, I mean, what is the plan of the BJP, how you will tackle this issue? And especially it is coming up in your constituency because it's a large trading community which is reeling under that problem. So how do you really plan to tackle this issue?
If you would recall that in 2006, when Justice Sabharwal gave this decision about ceiling of all these establishments in Delhi, it was probably February 2006. I used to be the BJP president, and I think I have led this agitation for handling this issue for almost over 1 year or so in Delhi itself. And 2007, in fact, we forced the then government to make some amendments in the master plan. They had to appoint Tejendra Khanna committee. I was made a part of the Tejendra Khanna committee, although there was a different government. So all these years I have been constantly involved with this. Then there was a law in parliament which then again when we came in power we ensured that this law remains there so that people are helped. Now in spite of all those master plan changes, there were some issues where people were still like not taken care of, or in spite of those massive changes in master plan, still there were violations. So realizing the people's grievance and their suffering, or maybe whatever disturbances were being noticed, I know that myself, Mr. Hardeep Puri, Mr. Anil Bajal, Mr. VCDDA, and other MPs, we discussed quite a bit about it. A lot of amendments were made in the master plan, and according to that, a majority of the people got relief also further in Delhi. But there are still some people who could not get relief because the amendments which we suggested, not everything was accepted by the Supreme Court. And we are still continuing to, you can say, present our case on behalf of the people who are still affected by ceiling in the Supreme Court. So we promise we'll continue with our efforts.
Okay.
But all these traders, they all know that it has nothing to do with BJP, it has nothing to do with the current national government. In fact, Delhi government has been playing a negative role in all this and just politicking about it rather than trying to search for a real relief solution. So I can assure you that not many traders are right now affected by it, but whosoever is still affected, our commitment is that we don't want anybody to suffer in this country, and ensure that any law which is not people friendly or which is useless or maybe which is promoting Inspector Raj, etc., we have to ultimately take consent of the parliament to sort of show them the way to the dustbin. And I am happy that more than 1500 laws have been shown their way out in the last 5 years. So that tells you about the intention of the government. And we enacted 100 new laws in parliament.
So what I understand from what you're saying is that this ceiling, whatever has not been dealt with, it's an ongoing process. The party is committed to resolving this issue.
It is an ongoing process. Party is not only committed. Party has been consistently trying and doing its best. And I would say, I would praise Mr. Hardeep Puri for that. And he's very considerate about the whole issue.
Right.
He's quite compassionate about it. He's trying to find out real solutions to the whole problem. And he is pursuing the whole case on the behalf of his ministry in the Supreme Court quite well.
Coming to the political arithmetic which is panning out in Delhi, it looks like a three-cornered contest between Congress, BJP and the Aam Aadmi Party. For BJP, who is the bigger enemy, Congress or Aam Aadmi Party?
Really, I can't answer because there is no contest at all. But if I say that then it smacks some sort of an arrogance. But that is the real fact that I see on the ground. So that's why I say that probably the whatever contest is happening, it's between the Aam Aadmi Party and the Congress Party for the second and the third position.
Dr. Harsh Vardhan, Arvind Kejriwal is raking up the statehood issue in this election of 2019. He says that this is the main rallying point of 2019 elections for Delhi. Many people have said that it's a foolish campaign, it doesn't hold water. What is your assessment? You're a senior leader, you've seen Delhi very closely.
I think these many people are exactly correct. I mean, that's a good statement that you made, and I think they are right. All these many
That's
people,
a statement which I read in the papers and the reports which are coming.
Many people who said like that, I think they are saying the right thing. You see, you please understand, it's almost 4.5 years since Arvind Kejriwal came to power. He promised big 70 things. He hasn't fulfilled his promise even on one. I can enumerate all those 70 things, but probably that time doesn't permit and allow that. 500 schools, 20 colleges, Wi-Fi, this, that. So many things he promised to us. Now 4.5 years he spent and wasted, 4.5 years he wasted on abusing the Prime Minister, criticizing everybody in this country, and just praising him, hurling self-praises on him. In spite of all this, all his colleagues, friends, they have departed from the scene of Aam Aadmi Party in the last couple of years, you have seen yourself. Now, when he is facing defeat convincingly, because you can see that he got 67 seats. He is pleading before someone who has got 0 seat in the last assembly election. What is this? And it is with the Congress Party, whom he always rated as corrupt party. He promised that he will send Sheila Dixit to jail. He lodged an FIR against her. He said he has struck loads of, sabut against her.
Aisa kuch bhi nahi kiya unhone.
And aisa kuch bhi nahi hua. Now, since 4.5 years have passed, he hasn't, he doesn't have any issue to talk about.
Dr.
So suddenly, no, let me explain, because this is very relevant question. Now he is raking up this issue, statehood. What was he doing about it for the last 4.5 years? That's number one question. Number two statement that I would like to tell you and place on record is that in last 70 years, BJP is the only party which has on record officially showed its commitment to even discuss and consider the issue of statehood for Delhi. And that's where Lal Krishna Advani ji, our most respected leader, who was the Deputy Home Minister, Deputy Prime Minister and also Home Minister, in August 2003, he for the first time brought the statehood bill in Parliament, and it was after a lot of deliberations. Even we in the Delhi BJP were all consulted and discussed, because Delhi is a very complex thing. You can't give police to the state government. That bill couldn't see the light of the day, because it was sent to a select committee because of opposition. Then there were early elections in 2004, etc., etc. That shows, number one, our official commitment. Atalji's Sarkar government did that. Now, right now, you have this leader who stages a dharna at India Gate. He says he's going to stop the Republic Day parade. He says he appeals to policemen to revolt. He calls his chief secretary at midnight in the night and ensures he is beaten badly, and hundreds of things like that. He has all his 3 dozen MLAs, with all those charges of different nature, almost variety of charges, FIRs, this, that. And now, can any responsible government, I said, not only in India, but anywhere in the world. He is the man who says, I am an anarchist, and he feels proud in saying that he is an anarchist. Can anybody in this world ever give this full statehood, or for that matter, police to such an anarchist? Tomorrow he will start saying, I will not allow the President of India to come out of Rashtrapati Bhavan because I have got the police. I will not allow the Prime Minister to come out of 7 Lok Kalyan Marg. I will not allow such and such foreign dignitary to say the ambassador of China to land in Delhi because that means so I think.
So, Dr. Harshvardhan, aapka ye kehne ka matlab hai ki jo statehood issue jo Arvind Kejriwal utha rahe hain is chunav mein, uske koi takers nahi hain aur jo voting hogi wo is issue par at least Delhi ki janta nahi vote karegi logon ko.
Delhi ki janta bahut vivekshil hai. मेरे ख्याल से वो ना इशू ऐसा नहीं होता ना कि आपने होर्डिंग लगा दिया 500 करोड़ रुपए आप प्रचार पे खर्च करते हैं दिन रात अपनी होर्डिंग दूसरे स्टेट्स में भी लगाते रहते हैं जहां आपका कोई अस्तित्व नहीं है और आप सोचें कि वो इशू बन जाएगा. इशू वो होता है जो लोगों के दिल का इशू होता है. और मैं आपको बता दूँ, मैं एक महीने से सड़क पर हूँ, ज़मीन पर हूँ. ज़मीन पर एक ही इशू है, लोग डेस्परेट हैं, लोग नरेंद्र मोदी जी को दोबारा से प्रधानमंत्री बनाना चाहते हैं. उनके मन में एक इच्छा है कि नरेंद्र मोदी अगर भारत में दोबारा आएंगे तो आने वाले समय में जो उनका सपनों का नया भारत बनेगा उसमें हर एक के जीवन में खुशी आएगी, हर एक के जीवन का दुख दर्द दूर होगा. गरीब लोगों से मैं बात करता हूँ, बोलते हैं नरेंद्र मोदी मेरे लिए भगवान है, मेरे लिए मसीहा है.
डॉक्टर हर्षवर्धन, इसमें कोई दो राय नहीं है कि जो मोदी जी की जो पॉपुलैरिटी है उस पर किसी को भी डाउट नहीं है और सब लोगों का ये मानना है कि मोदी जी से पॉपुलर लीडर इस समय एटलीस्ट कोई भी नहीं है उनके सामने अगर टक्कर करें. लेकिन जो अपोजिशन का बार बार ये कहना है कि बीजेपी नेशनलिज्म को उठाती है, ऑब्वियसली इंटरनल सिक्योरिटी इज़ अ वेरी बिग इशू, लेकिन नेशनलिज्म को वो हाइपर नेशनलिज्म का डेफिनेशन देता है विपक्ष और फिर कहता है कि जो ब्रेड एंड बटर इशूज़ हैं बीजेपी उस पर बात नहीं करती बल्कि नेशनलिज्म पर बात करती है.
दोनों बात सुन लीजिए आप. गरीबों के कल्याण के लिए बीजेपी ने जितनी स्कीम्स बनाई, हर एक स्कीम के आज करोड़ों की तादाद में लाभार्थी हैं. आप मुद्रा की बात करिए, उज्ज्वला की बात करिए, आप सोशल सिक्योरिटी की बात करिए, आप जनधन की बात करिए, आप डायरेक्ट बैंक ट्रांसफ़र की बात करिए, आप आयुष्मान की बात करिए, आप बिजली देने की बात करिए, बिजली हर गाँव तक पहुँचाने की बात करिए, आप सबको मकान देने की, ये सारी जो स्कीम्स थी ये बेसिक स्कीम्स हैं, बेसिक इश्यूज हैं, इनके लाखों नहीं करोड़ों में लाभार्थी हैं. ठीक है, अब दूसरी आप बात कह रहे हैं नेशनलिज्म. अब नेशनलिज्म मुझे पता नहीं कि क्या आपकी डेफिनेशन है नेशनलिज्म की. अगर मैं अपने जीवन में मेरा काम ईमानदारी से करता हूँ तो ये नेशनलिज्म है
बिल्कुल
मेरे हिसाब से. अब अगर देश के 126 ज़िले जो नक्सलिज्म से प्रभावित थे उनमें से 40 ज़िलों को नक्सलाइट फ्री कर दिया, 3000 नक्सलाइट्स को सरेंडर करा दिया, डोकलाम के अंदर नरेंद्र मोदी जी के नेतृत्व के कारण जो है चाइना को भी जो है एक तरह से लिटरली वापस अपना कदम लेना पड़ा, और अगर प्रधानमंत्री जी के नेतृत्व में उनकी गाइडेंस के अंदर अगर उरी जैसी घटनाएं जो जवाब देने वाली हो गई और बालाकोट हो गया और जो चीन जैसा देश और अगर वो ब्लैकमेल कर रहा था मसूद के इशू के ऊपर और आज आपने देखा कि प्रधानमंत्री की जो इंटरनेशनल डिप्लोमेटिक उनकी जो स्टेट्समैनशिप है उसके कारण चीन को भी जो है अल्टीमेटली घुटने टेकने पड़े और उसको इंटरनेशनल टेररिस्ट. तो अब इन इश्यूज को, ये इश्यूज के लिए हमें तो बात ही करने की ज़रूरत नहीं पड़ती. बात हम क्यों करें, देश के लोग खुद देख रहे हैं ना. आखिर इस देश में 26 नवंबर 2008 भी हुआ था, हम सब ने देखा है. मैं तो असेंबली का इलेक्शन लड़ रहा था दिल्ली का, 29 नवंबर को असेंबली का इलेक्शन था. बम्बई में इतनी दुर्भाग्यपूर्ण घटना हुई, किसी ने अपने ज़बान से कोई प्रोटेस्ट भी नहीं किया. यहाँ अगर मान लीजिए वही आर्मी है, वही जवान है, वही फाइटर प्लेन्स है, वही सब पायलट हैं, सब कुछ तो वही है ना, लीडरशिप का ही तो फ़र्क है ना. अभी लोग मजाक करते थे 56 इंच 56 इंच, तो अभी उनको देखने को मिल गया ना कि प्राइम मिनिस्टर ने तो 56 की जगह 76 इंच अपना सीना दिखा दिया. दैट इज़ लीडरशिप. अभी स्पेस का पावर हम बन गए यानी अमेरिका चाइना और रशिया के बाद चौथे नंबर पे आ गए. तो ये विजन है ना, लीडरशिप है. मैं पता करता हूँ तो मुझे पता लगता है साइंटिस्ट लोग कहते हैं, हम लोग पुरानी सरकारों को भी कहते थे तो कोई बात ही नहीं करता था, कोई सुनता भी नहीं था, कोई ध्यान भी नहीं देता था, कोई हिम्मत भी नहीं करता था. प्राइम मिनिस्टर ने टारगेट दिया, टारगेट को फॉलो किया, इम्प्लीमेंट कराया और 3-4 साल में स्पेस के अंदर भी सब कुछ करके दिखा दिया. अब ये नेशनलिज्म क्या है, हर एक व्यक्ति की ड्यूटी है ना अपने देश के लिए जीना मरना. तो अगर नरेंद्र मोदी जी के पास वो जज्बा है, उसके हिसाब से वो काम कर रहे हैं, तो इसमें उनका कसूर क्या है?
आखिरी दो सवाल. पहला ये कि 7 सीटें हैं दिल्ली में, तो कितनी सीट्स बीजेपी के खाते में आ रही हैं?
ज़मीन पे स्थिति देखने के बाद जो असेसमेंट कर रहा हूँ, मुझे लगता है कि मुझे कोई डाउट नहीं है कि 7 की 7 सीटें भाजपा को मिलेंगी.
और जो वो लोग जो ये कह रहे हैं कि मोदी मैजिक 2014 से थोड़ा सा फीका पड़ गया है, उनको आप क्या जवाब देंगे?
अभी 2019 में मेरे हिसाब से मोदी वेव की जगह तो मोदी सुनामी है, और मोदी मैजिक की जगह मोदी सुपर मैजिक है.
ओके.
और ये आपको 23 तारीख को कंफर्म होगा. आपको 23 तारीख को ये पता लगेगा कि इस देश में लोग आने वाले भविष्य में ये महागठबंधन, महाठगबंधन, ये जो सारी चीज़ें हैं, ये सब बंद हो जाएंगी. लोग हिम्मत ही नहीं करेंगे इस तरह के अलायंसेस करने की, क्योंकि ये देश में, इस देश का विवेक जो है, आप देखेंगे पहली बार चुनाव के बाद कि कितने विवेकपूर्ण तरीके से लोगों ने अपनी देश के हित में जो है वोट किया है. और मैं ये समझता हूँ कि 2019 में मोदी जी की जीत, ये भारत की जीत है. और मोदी जी की जीत जो है, ये भारत की विकास यात्रा की जीत है. इसलिए सबको 12 तारीख को दिल्ली में और बाकी जहाँ भी चुनाव बचा है, वहाँ बड़ी संख्या में आके वोट डालना चाहिए. सिर्फ वोट डालते समय केवल इतना ध्यान करिए, आपका राष्ट्र धर्म क्या है और आपका दिल, आपकी कॉन्शियस देश के लिए क्या कहती है.
With this beautiful message, I thank you and I also wish you all the best for your grueling campaign which you have for which the countdown has already begun. So thanks so much, Dr. Harsh Vardhan.
Thank you.
So that's it on this episode of our election special interview. See you next time with another personality. Goodbye and thanks for your time.